The second part of the symposium will come in two parts, one starting now, the other one in the afternoon, and has to do with curatorial case studies based on exhibition histories. And both parts will be moderated jointly by Sofía Hernández Chong, curator at Cisneros Collection Foundation, and Jens Hoffmann, director of the Jewish Museum. And basically, it has to do with the importance of researching exhibition histories from Latin America, something that hasn't been done enough, that needs to be done. And the idea is to explore how our guest curators through their exhibitions expanded, questioned, deconstructed our understanding of what art from Latin America could be. The case studies that will be presented, three later in the afternoon, of course are not the only ones, but part of a bigger constellation which needs to be further researched and could include many others like the second Habana Bienal, Pablo Hergenhoff's Anthropophagia, America's Bride of the Sun, Federico Moraes' first Mercosur Bienal, Kamitzer and Tim's Global Conceptualism, Mezquita and Pedrosa's Cartographies, Insight in Tijuana, The Last Version, Basualdo's Of Adversity We Lived and Tropicalia, the many exhibitions done by the Bronx Museum here, including Juan Downey and the recent Supercuadras, et cetera, et cetera. So the need to do this research in order to also build the histories of all these different efforts, of these networks of efforts. Here in the Guggenheim itself, the exhibition, the Emerging Decade of 1966, Latin American painters and painting became an important part of the research I did in building the exhibition upstairs under the same sun. The exhibition was curated by then director Thomas Messer after he traveled in 1964 through eight major Latin American capitals, Mexico, Caracas, Bogota, Lima, Sao Paulo, Santiago, Buenos Aires, and except Montevideo, I mean the usual suspects, in search of the best Latin American painting, in an attempt to find works of art that expressed the essence of the region and which were both free of pictorial exoticism and neutral abstraction, which is a pity because he didn't like abstraction. We don't have Lydia Clark, we don't have Elio Tisica, we don't have Matthias Geritz, we don't have, I can go on and on. As part of his research, Messer was in correspondence with some of the major art intellectuals of each country, amongst other Matthias Geritz in Mexico, Marta Traba in Colombia, Samuel Paz in Argentina, et cetera, et cetera. In words of Messer, the expenditure of so much time, money, and effort on a purely regional project is unusual in this era of globally oriented museums. This is 1966. Nevertheless, I must point to my endeavors apologetically rather than complacently, for they were clearly insufficient in light of the complexity of the task. As Messer discovered, he said, a true Latin American art, if it exists, will be rooted in the realities of Latin American life, whatever that means. I show you just some images that we found in the archive of the exhibition. I mean, the first is a copy, the cover of the catalog. The catalog is available to download from the Guggenheim's webpage, so just Google the Emerging Decade Guggenheim. It's an amazing catalog. More interesting than the works showed is Cornel Kappa's photographs of studio visits to the artists, so really showing how the artist lives in an attempt to de-exoticize them and normalize them. And then installation photos, here you have Armando Morales painting, Cislo next to it, here some more Cislo paintings, Maestro Botero that we're happy to have in our collection, next to Rojas, a Leufert painting. There's another photo that sadly we don't have, but has Reverón also. The photos are during the installation process, so it's not that Messer was an avant-garde exhibition designer placing them in the floor. And here we have Coronel from Mexico. So basically, well, this need to review and re-examine our histories and question them. Each of our guests has 10 minutes to present the exhibitions that they'll talk about. We're using the US-American model. I'm sorry for it. I would really like each one to speak an hour about their own projects, but this is a talk show format, so what can we do? And then they will enter in conversation with Sofía and Jens. And we won't read biographies because we won't have time, but again, they're in their programs. We'll start with Mari Carmen, after we'll move with Gerardo Mosquera, and finally with Max Hinderer. So I would like you all to welcome Mari Carmen Ramírez. Mari Carmen, we're honored to have you here.
Thank you. thank you. I'm delighted to be here. Thank you to Pablo for the invitation and to all the staff of the Guggenheim who made it possible. It's been exactly 10 years since the opening of Inverted Utopias, Avant-Garde Art in Latin America, the exhibition co-curated by myself and Hector Olea, the Mexican experimental writer, translator, and theoretician, also architect and curator, at the Museum of Fine Arts Houston in 2004. With a retrospect of a full decade behind, I welcome the opportunity to revisit this show and its pivotal insight in the critical context of this symposium. It could be argued that to the extent that exhibitions are made of objects and objects are fragments, an exhibition is impossible for an exhibition to tell a complete story. Therefore, exhibitions are intrinsically limited to the role of provocations. And Inverted Utopias was no exception. The starting point for this show was another major exhibition that Olea and I organized for the Centro de Arte Reina Sofía in Madrid in 2000. The Heterotopias Medio Siglo Sin Lugar, a show that provided the historical component to the monumental Versiones del Sur, which was conceived as Spain's millennial tribute to Latin America. A spectacular event that included five exhibitions focused mostly on Latin American contemporary art and curated by some of our colleagues here, Gerardo Mosquera, Adriano Pedrosa, Ivo Mesquita, and others. Whether understood in terms of Foucault's heterotopias or in terms of inverted utopias, the Latin American insight that we proposed embodied an alternative pole of artistic innovation and experimentation. One that was not only autonomous, but was in clear tension with the legacy of Eurocentric modernism. Reset in Inverted Utopias, the richness and complexity of the largely overlooked phenomenon of the avant-garde in Latin America triggered the attempt to map out, however tentative or incomplete, a set of cardinal coordinates for both its presentation and interpretation in the space of the museum. Such an approach stemmed from the passionate debates about the representation of Latin American art that had taken hold of the US as well as the European mainstream in the 1980s and early 90s as a result of multiculturalism, identity politics, and the so-called culture wars of the period. For those of us involved with Latin American art, the critique of the kind of essentialism embodied in the notion of the fantastic became the rallying cry. From today's perspective, informed by globalization and a renewed universalism that boasts of having erased geographic borders, it is easy to forget that until well into the 1990s, this fallacious construct dominated museological accounts of Latin American art in the US and abroad. The standard vehicle for such a reductionist paradigm was the historical and geographic survey imbued with the linear naivete of cause and effect, exemplified by panoramic shows of the 1980s and 90s, such as Art of the Fantastic, Latin America, 1920 to 1970 at the Indianapolis Museum of Art in 1986, and that was one of many others. In the specific case of both heterotopias and inverted utopias, we sought a way out of such a conceptual impasse through the relational model of the constellation theorized by Olea on the basis of Theodor Adorno's negative dialectics. Adorno's thinking, indeed, was mirrored in the dialectical flexibility that informed this show, focused on the critical decades of the avant-garde, that is, the 1920s and 1960s. Circumventing art historical parameters, such a theoretical framework condenses rather than illustrates destabilizing themes, innovative approaches, or even regional sensibilities with regard to modernism and its commonplaces. It does suggest that the idea of inversion of the worn-out utopias of modernism was more a political stance than an aesthetic naivete or an exercise of style. The constellatory model thus allowed us to assemble works by means of luminous points, that is, key developments or singular visions that expose the nexus and oppositions between these artists, their works, and the specific context of art production. It went back and forth from adaptations to innovations, from the questioning of central paradigms to unique contributions, not only to the region, but to 20th century art as a whole. Within this framework, Inverted Utopias brought together 350 works by 63 avant-garde pioneers in the 50,000 square foot area of the Museum of Fine Arts Houston's Mies van der Rohe building. Organized in six constellations arranged around some conceptual antinomies, the works conveyed a more complex presentation of the issues at stake. Foregrounding proposals of the 1960s produced under military, repressive, or colonial regimes in countries like Argentina, Colombia, Mexico, Venezuela, and Puerto Rico, the constellation of play and grief exposed the paradoxes at work in such a context. By contrast, Universal and Vernacular showcase the production of the generation of avant-garde pioneers represented, among others, by Jules Solar, the School of the South, and the Brazilian Vicente Dorrego Monteiro. In turn, progression and rupture, in turn, encompass pieces by the by now well-known South American concrete and constructive art groups, the Argentinian Arte Madí, the Brazilian concrete and neoconcrete groups, as well as masters like Torres Garcia and Lucio Fontana. A fourth constellation, vibrational and stationary, focus on the idea of movement by unexpectedly pairing the pioneering work of Siqueiros and the artistic team of Ejercicio Plástico, the 1933 experimental mural painted in the outskirts of Buenos Aires and represented, of course, in the show by a video, with the Venezuelan constructive and kinetic artists such as Jesús Soto, Carlos Cruz Diez, and Alejandro Otero. As a counterpoint to these investigations, we also positioned Gego, then a relatively unknown artist in the US, with a group of her early parallactical sculptures that dialogue with the work of Soto and Cruz Diez. A fifth constellation showcased works that stimulated the senses, particularly the senses of touch, as well as sight, through works that require viewer interaction or immersion in the particular environment. Cryptic and Committed, in turn, introduced the highly political conceptual art practices that emerged in South American countries during the 60s and 70s at the height of political repression. The malleability of the constellatory grouping allows for the repositioning of artists, collective proposals, and movements within a dynamic, transversal reading, not only of history, but also of sensibility. And here we're seeing one of the most controversial pairings of the exhibition, which was a dialogue between Reverón and Soto, particularly with the white vibrations of 1959-60. In this way, it is capable of embracing, in the minimal, always utopian room of an exhibition area, the dialectical tension that the juxtaposition and comparison of disparate tendencies generates. Thus, these constellations provided a ductile approach to the art of the region in comparative terms that underscored their affinities and/or differences. And this is an important point, since to date, there is no comparative history of the art produced in all of these countries. In this way, Inverted Utopias represented an attempt to tell another story of the avant-garde, which is not exactly the official one. One aimed at inscribing lesser-known yet instrumental creators, forerunners of this approach to modern art, and unintentionally to modernism, postmodernism, I'm sorry. Indeed, the selection deliberately left out the well-established names associated until then with Latin American art: Mata, Lam, Botero, Frida, Diego, or even Tamayo. In their place, we showcase artists who were either unknown or under-recognized in their countries of origin, and most of which continue to be under-recognized. This included, among many others, Vicente Dorrego Monteiro from Brazil, El Machete, the organ of the Mexican Painters and Technical Workers Union, instead of Rivera or any of the other well-known quantities, Debra Arango from Colombia, Carlos Raquel Rivera from Puerto Rico, El Techo de la Ballena from Venezuela, José Balmes from Chile, whom we position as a proto-conceptual, and the Ciclo Experimental de Arte that took place in Rosario, Argentina in 1967-68. More importantly, the selection privileged what Olea called the artist as theoretician, that is, those whose artistic practice was embedded in theory. Hence, the exhibition catalog included over 100 documents. Its comprehensive research-oriented scope stands for a productive means to expand and understand the displaced utopias of modernism. These broad parameters are the essential issue, the crux of these introductory remarks, under whose terms our curatorial proposal was anything but a canon. Finally, beyond the exhibition model and iconoclastic group of artists that it introduced, the impact of inverted utopias outlasted it in two concrete ways. First, both the theoretical parameters handled, as well as the conceptual flexibility at play, suggested a viable blueprint for the long-term development of the core Latin American art collection at the MFAH. Clusters of works culled from the constellations of inverted utopias now constitute highlights of the rapidly expanding collection. These include major examples of pioneers and visionaries, such as Schultz Solar, Siqueiros, Torres Garcia, a large representation of concrete and constructive art anchored by the Adolfo Lerner collection, works produced with light and water, as well as utopian installations or fully interactive site-specific environments. From this point of view, taking risks early on with artistic manifestations that were still lacking the mainstream sanction proved to be an efficient collection-building strategy. At another level, the emphasis on research and documentation at the core of both heterotopias and inverted utopias provided the seminal impulse for the creation of the International Center for the Arts of the Americas Landmark Initiative. I refer to Documents of 20th Century Latin American and Latino Art, which is a digital archive and publications project involving a network of 13 research teams and over 150 researchers and digital professionals that operated between 2005 and 2014 in 16 Latin American and US cities. The team succeeded in digitizing, cataloging, and annotating over 14,000 primary sources for the study of Latin American and Latino art that are being made available free of charge through the project's website, as well as through a series of annotated document anthologies. The ultimate goal of this initiative is to gather together the intellectual production of Latin American artists in order to show that the region not only produced outstanding art, but it also produced original theory. And that's one of the key points. I hope we can continue to discuss that later on, because despite the expansion of the circuits and the fact that Latin American art is everywhere today, there is still a lack of recognition about the real originality of the thinking that went into the making of this art. Latin American artists are still not recognized for their contributions to theory or the original aspects that they contributed to problems of and issues of 20th century and 21st century art. Olea and I concluded then as now that through their capacity to revise or displace the familiar syntax of art historical narratives, exhibitions like Heterotopias and Inverted Utopias embodied the potential to open up a space of confrontation and discovery, leading to previously unsuspected relationships and tensions. As critics or participant viewers, as scholars or audiences, we are compelled to make sense of the conceptual and stylistic disorder that the exhibition installs to this end, a structured chaos under the semblance of a coherent wholeness. Nothing else. Thank you.
Thank you, Pablo, and thank you, Guggenheim, whatever that means, for this invitation. Anti-America was the first broad contemporary Latin American art show to be conceived, curated, organized, and funded in the South and exported to the North. More importantly, the exhibition redefined Latin American art and the very idea of Latin America. It was, quoting from the catalog, a provocation to look in a more problematized way at the art from the continent and at the continent from the art. The show reacted against and confronted prevailing stereotypes. It remapped the continent by including for the first time in a Latin American show, African Americans, Chicano Chicana, Native American, and New Yorkian artists, as well as others from the English-speaking Caribbean. While Argentina was excluded on purpose in a playful comment against totalizing notions about Latin America. Quotas per country were not only intentionally avoided, but subverted. Nevertheless, Anti-America proclaimed a strategic integration not only for the region, but for the entire post-colonial world, aware of the isolationist danger emanating from radical relativism. The exhibition tried out a performative and critical notion of the continent and paraphrased Borges, being Latin American is an act of faith. It advocated recognizing the heterogeneity of our societies and affirming ourselves in the fragment. Anti-America tried to seize space for Latin American art and to legitimate it in its own terms and from its own agenda. Dan Cameron wrote that it presented an America being considered by itself, for itself, and about itself. But the show was not a propaganda operation. The curation and the catalog and world texts were very critical to the many problems and inequalities in the continent, and especially to identity neurosis and to devious narratives of integration. The exhibition presented art from Latin America intertwined with the complexities and contradictions of its diverse contexts, assuming them even in its own structure. The show proclaimed its mixed relational character, in short, its inauthenticity in response to all-encompassing accounts, both in art, culture, and society. Contrary to most shows on Latin American art, Anti-America was not a survey, but a thematic exhibition, even if its theme was quite flexible. It was described in the catalog as an open essay on the continent, where the artists were chosen for proposing a consciousness of the Americas. However, I would say that the main subject was the show itself as an operation for critical cultural action. Here, the curation, the curatorial perspective, was more important than the curating. Going beyond Latin America, Crisis was perhaps the biggest show ever organized on the issue of art and confrontation in general. It presented the global relevance of Latin American art of social and cultural descent, which I find paradigmatic because of its intricate yet plausible integration of politics and aesthetics, and because of its diversity, wide-ranging nature, and concrete achievements. However, the exhibition tried not to promote a cliché that would identify Latin American art as political. It followed Anti-America's approach by taking on a fragmentary and provocative perspective that looked into the continent through its conflicts, complexities, and contradictions. It also included artists from other continents with pieces that referred to the show's content and that contributed to its discourse. Crisis was neither a strictly historical nor an encyclopedic exhibition, nor was it an exhaustive overview or even a definitive anthology. Instead, it offered a critical curatorial vision in the experiment-creating sense that Sarath Maharaj has posited, one that articulated a polyphony of dialogues, meanings, and provocations. This approach allowed works from different time periods to dialogue among themselves and the exhibition space in a Bakhtinian sense, reaffirming, contradicting, and resignifying them, giving rise to new discourses via their manifold relationships, as we can see here. Here, it was at the exhibition entrance, you see Torres Garcia's inverted map, you know, idealistically pointing up, and then it was in contrast for with Fossa Comun mass grave by Kamnitzer, who was there, you know, telling about the harsh reality of violence and repression. And next to it was Felix Gonzalez Torres' untitled passport, which was just like a blank piece of paper, so telling about the utopia of a world without passports. Frida Kahlo, a major artist who I admire, was not featured. As a commentary against the stereotype of Latin American magical realist otherness that she has been turned into. The Two Fridas by Yeguas del Apocalipsis usurped Kahlo's place in the show, positioned between two classic works of Mexican muralism. The exhibition tried to unlearn official narratives, sketching out other possibilities for writing and unwriting Latin American art. For example, the exhibition underscored how much art created during the Cuban Revolution insisted upon podium, speech, and language, shedding light on the rhetorical, manipulative, and media-related nature of that historical process. The exhibition criticized its own main venue, the Palacio de Bellas Artes, an emblem of Mexico City and a superficial site for the arts full of symbolic implications. As we can see here in this work by Downey, so the Yanomami Indian was filming people entering at the at the Bellas Artes lobby with the grandeur character of the place. Or here with R, who sat like a public toilet right there at the building's entrance that was in use all along the exhibition, or the Jimmy Durant's vulture that was, you know, set there looking into the palace. Additionally, the show reactivated Bellas Artes' famous murals, which were interrelated with contemporary works, bringing them to participate in the exhibition. Siqueiro's great utopian mural, The New Democracy, was linked to Che Guevara, the utmost utopian symbol, via a Kamnitzer print and a Cuban 10 peso banknote minted during the paradoxical Cuban Central Bank presidency of Guevara himself, who was an idealist opposed to money. In his official capacity, Guevara signed the new paper money as Che, in a deconstructivist and Duchampian gesture that allowed the banknote to be presented as a work of art. So I had Che Guevara as one of the artists in my show. an exhibition on art and confrontation has to confront itself. Crisis did this and suffered the consequences. Thank you.
Thanks everyone for being here and holding on to this event for such a long day. We're only starting. So thanks a lot to Pablo for the invitation, for Christina, and for the conference team here, Ellen, Sarah, and for the theater team, Brenda and Sebastian, for taking care that everything is going well today. So I've talked about the Potosí principle, the show I'm going to talk about, Principio Potosí, a lot of times, like an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 1 day, 3 days, seminars. I never did it in 10 minutes. So I made 10 points to see whether each point would fit in 1 minute, and I hope we have the chance later in the discussion to talk a bit more if there are any questions. So Principio Potosí, this was our logo, was an exhibition and publication project that developed over an intense 3.5 year period of research, travel, encounters, discussions, seminars, and finally, 3 exhibition venues that were Madrid at the Reina Sofía, in Berlin at the Haus der Kulturen der Welt, and in La Paz at Museo Nacional de Arte y Museo Nacional de Etnografía y Folklore in 2010. Well, the Bolivian venue was actually in 2011. The exhibition was curated by, and we had a catalog, right, which was published in 3 languages, English, Spanish, and German. The exhibition was curated by Alice Kreischer and Andrea Siegmann and myself. None of us professional curators, that is, none of us achieving a career as professional curators, but all of us willing to develop new formats of knowledge production and of experiencing the space within political debates, let's say. That's what we have in common. So we did together Principio Potosí, which was a big challenge. The title originates from the famous Spanish silver city located in today's Bolivian Andes and over 4,000 meters over the sea level. It is at the same time the epicenter of Spanish colonial economy between the end of the 16th century and the 17th century. So this city played for us a very important starting point to think about art production alongside with the production of ideological hegemony and global economy. And we took Potosí, inspired by the book of Eduardo Galeano called The Open Veins of Latin America, which I believe many of you here present know, because Eduardo Galeano states the Potosí, what we call the Potosí principle, but he states Potosí as the paradigm of the forms and modes of exploitation on the Latin American continents. So Potosí is the city here represented in a painting by Miguel Gaspar Berrío of the 18th century. This city with the big silver mountain you see in, on the back of the city, the Cerro Rico, famous Cerro Rico. Principio Potosí then would mean the beginning of something, the beginning of Potosí, or Potosí as the beginning in Spanish, or Potosí the principle, as I said, that principle that we encounter all throughout modernity as modes of exploitation that give, of human and natural resources, that gives the basis for the development of a global market. Walter Mignolo has talked about it. And the beginning of exactly that narration of modernity and coloniality, beginning with what Eduardo Galeano posts as the beginning or the first chapter of his book. So Principio would be on one side, the beginning of this narration, and on the other side, the analysis of the mechanisms, the logic, or the rules behind this whole epoch, the rules of how exploitation actually works. So what we did is divide our analysis in 4 chapters, choosing 20 colonial Baroque paintings from the context of the famous city, and putting about 20 contemporary artist positions or groups or initiatives in direct dialogue with these paintings and asking them about the ideological function that art production played for the emergence of that global economy in the 16th and 17th century, and what function art fulfills today in the contemporary capitalism with its new emerging economic centers, as Walter Mignolo also pointed out, China, Russia, the BRIC states, or to add from the perspective of Principio Potosí, the United Arabic Emirates, that are very important in this context. So we invited a lot of artists to give reflections on that. Most of them came or lived in or researched a long time in the United Arabic Emirates or in Russia or in China and other countries all over the globe. And they did exactly this research on the ideological function of art production in the emergence of new booming markets of global importance. We had these four chapters, which one deals with the extended notion of what Marx called the so-called primitive accumulation. The term comes from earlier, Ricardo. However, the so-called primitive accumulation we try to understand within contemporary global contexts as, at the same time, in, as the rule or one of the functioning modes of coloniality. Then we try to understand how this relates to the situation of labor conditions, human rights, in these booming centers and booming economies throughout coloniality until our contemporaneity. The third chapter with the cryptical title, How Can We Sing the Alien Song in the Land of the Lord, comes from a book from the 16th century. We try to think about how is actually hegemony being produced, how are ideological formations being produced through the use, for example, of culture and arts, or how do culture and arts, visual arts mainly in our from our focus, do back up the ideological formations that ground the economical production, taking ideology as the way how people relate or people see themselves within their relation of productions. Althusser namely thought of that as some kind of vision, the way how the subject is produced, perceiving himself within his context of or her context of production. That is hegemony in the cultural field and is related to art production and economic production. Fourth chapter would be the world upside down, which is also a notion that already comes up through the chronicler Waman Poma de Ayala, who we heard of, who was a 16th century chronicler in El Alto Peru and the viceroyalty of Peru, and who talked about all the conditions of life are actually put in upside down. We had this guide who would show you around all the different places of the exhibition and give you introductions into the space, what the living labor conditions of people, for example, in China or in Argentina in the soy fields. Here you have some views on the complexity of layering of the exhibition. In contemporary Bolivia, Russia, China, again, here a work by Studielat and so, if we want to understand coloniality, we cannot only see it as a historical issue, and we cannot pretend that it's over. We have to assume that our, like in which situation can we speak, how can we enunciate critique? We cannot do it only within positioning and inverted discourse within the same walls of institutions that are interested or in expanding hegemony on the cultural field, or in reproducing it, however, or in installing national identity patterns or principles of free democracy or humanism. We have to think about that these are encrusted within modes of exploitation that are global ones as, yeah, for example, the construction, Guggenheim is, you know, involved in the construction, as is NYU and Louvre, of centers in Abu Dhabi. And there, for example, the interest of expanding humanist values on a global scale and within new economic centers is ingrained within the logic of production of these places, like the construction of new museum venues, etc. And these have been strictly criticized by human rights for many years. And this February here in the museum, through actions, you can find documentation of that on internet engines, search engines, etc. So we have to formulate spaces. We have to create spaces and formulate possibilities of rethinking our own perception of our own discourse. If we want to be critical about the history of modernity and forms of exploitation that persist until today, we have to understand that our perception might be false, and we might be seduced through these mechanisms that seduce our sensitivity, our self-perception, that Walter Mignolo already described, and I guess Sui Li will work out in her presentation. Our modes of self-perception, the self-perception of our discourse, is ingrained within global production. So we are only part, and our enunciation is part of this matrix, and our artistic production can only point towards possible spaces of enunciation of critique. We can never assume that we overcome the matrix I'm talking about, and we can never assume that we would be free of guilt. So I think it's very important, and I thank Pablo again to give the possibility to Principio Potosí articulate itself within this context, where we need to think about what it means to enunciate Latin American critique, or critique from the point of view of Latin America, within institutions that are looking to catch up on the global development. Let's say Western institutions that are looking to catch up with the global development of cultural representation within contemporary capitalism. I thank you very much for your attention, and we'll continue talking.
Hello, good morning. Thank you, everyone, for your very insightful presentations. I want to begin the conversation amongst us around the ideas that you threw based on exclusion. But before that, connected a little bit with the conversation that we had, or with the debate in the morning and the Q&A that followed, particularly with the word poesis from Aristoteles and the importance as it pertains to our own relationship to aesthetics in contemporary times. I think that one of the things, or one of the reasons for why this exhibition is here, one of the reasons for why we're all here sitting down, is to talk about how the representation or the recognition of the contributions of Latin American artists and thinkers has done to rethink the world, and not only the region. And in the case of the conversation today, what was interesting in the Q&A session was really sort of an exposure around the force of institutions, of which, whether we work independently or institutionally, we're abide to. One of the things that is quite particularly from this set of exhibitions is that all of the exhibitions, as opposed to the case studies for the afternoon, they're all collaboratively curated. They're all organized in teams of people and in collaboration, which I think that as a process already introduces something. The other thing that is common amongst all of them and is done in a very different way is that you explicitly exclude artists or thinkers from your exhibitions, and not only do so in the exhibitionary complex, but also within your very own public presentations about the project. I think that Max was not able to point that out, but I would like actually for him to begin the conversation right now by talking about the exclusions that were there and the recognitions or the misrecognitions felt that sort of are the seed of this exhibition. The projects of Mari Carmen and Gerardo are developed also from a very particular point of time, and also from knowing and experiencing a series of exhibitions that were misrepresentative or that were misleading of what was being created and thought in Latin America. Frida Kahlo seems to be constantly repeated as one of the images or the icons that your practices curatorially wanted to separate from. In the case of Max, which I think that it would be worth developing a little bit more, what is excluded in an analysis of sort of global capitalism today and a critique of labor from the visual arts is your own development that the exhibition Potosí Principle does, which is with baroque art. You chose to exclude or not to focus on, say, art from the early 20th century in Latin America that was also critique around industry and progress and not only and dehumanizing and so on. But you have chosen Baroque for a very specific reason, which is a kind of taking evangelical oriented work in painting to be able to identify in it a kind of inversion, not an inverted utopia necessarily, or a confrontation, but a kind of usage of the local, not scenery, but customs as a form of resistance or total resistance in the work. So there is a theory that the exhibition proposes around looking at the Baroque as a form of resistance rather than, say, decor. So my thinking is that if we could begin talking about not exactly the collaboration and the complicity that is involved in being able to clear up misunderstanding or misrepresentation and also be able to recognize what is there. If you could speak about the ways in which the exhibitions have done this, but also what are the works and what do the works do in the exhibition, once spatialized, that allow us to understand the complexities of misrecognition or misrepresentation in a new proposal to look at the region. So maybe we begin with you.
Should I start? Okay. Thank you for coming back to the Baroque paintings. I excluded them from the presentation right now because usually what is not seen as the bigger part of the exhibition that is contemporary contributions that deal with the phenomenons I've mentioned in my presentation. So Baroque painting, I think if we talk about exclusion in relation to Baroque paintings, I would like to emphasize in the fact that we chose about 20 paintings. It was super complicated to get original 20 paintings from Andean Baroque to Madrid, to Berlin, and then back to La Paz. We were interested in global circulation processes as this is the economic basis of everything we were talking about in the exhibition. So what we decided to exclude from the show was the paintings that we could not lend from museums or from churches in the Andes or, well, museums or private collections, private museums and state museums in both Madrid, also the Ethnographic Museum in Berlin, or museums in Bolivia. We excluded them and included their presence. That is, the 20 paintings we decided to show, to put on show, whether they were lent by the museums or the people who gave the paintings, or whether they were not, had their presence, the 20 first ones we chose. So if a painting was not given to us, we would make its absence present by including either a piece that is the same size or inviting artists to invent a new situation, and we narrate why the paintings didn't arrive to assist and take place at the exhibition. This included the forms of exclusion that are historically embedded, for example, of the participation of South American countries and their former colony countries, etc. And through this, we could point out how unbalanced actually the relationship between European institutions and South American institutions still are. Like Spanish museums, like Museo de America, not wanting to lend a painting because they say they were afraid it wouldn't come back. And all these stories, or a church in the Bolivian Andes that didn't want to lend us a painting because they said they want a Highland tractor to work the fields as an exchange, and they want 20 tickets. I think that says a lot, like airplane tickets to Madrid and back, that says a lot about the situation, also taking into consideration that the migration from the Bolivian Andes to Madrid is very big, right? So like, there's a lot of things to think about. And through this exclusion of these paintings, which was not our exclusion, but the exclusion of the
of the paintings through the circumstances our exhibition was embedded in, which was the a bit cynical celebration of 200 years of independence of several Latin American countries called the Bicentenario, celebrated by the Spanish, the biggest and most triumphal, like, which was kind of ridiculous. And so we made clear through the exclusion of these paintings and including their absence what the, let's say, real bilateral relations were. Or we tried to make this transparent.
Mari Carmen, can you tell us a little bit, considering that the making of exhibitions, and we looked at two cases, and also in the case of Gerardo, we looked at two exhibitions. They are also very much informed from a practice that emerged, a curatorial practice and an art historical method that emerged in contradistinction to what was happening there at the time.
Yes, well, earlier. To answer that question, my starting point is the fact that I strongly believe, and if there's anything that I have learned throughout 30 years I've been at this, is that every exhibition involves a strategy. And it's a strategy that is as both curatorial, but most importantly, it's political. And it's a strategy that needs to operate on the basis of the specific context in which you're doing that exhibition. Mm-hmm. So, heterotopias and inverted utopias, as I said before, were nurtured by, you know, all of these debates that took place in the 1980s and 90s concerning the representation of Latin American art, and all of us were rallying against, you know, the form of essentialism and reductionism, you know, that was present in all of those works. So focusing an exhibition in the context of these mega event called Versiones del Sur, which was supposedly Spain's tribute, you know, millennial tribute to Latin America, but some people could have read it as, you know, their attempt to neo-colonialize, you know, Latin America, and there was a lot of that going on. By focusing on the avant-garde, on all of these artists who had dealt with the notion of the avant-garde as a utopia movement, as artists who were pushing the limits of art, who were theorizing about that art, and who were in dialogue with the major movements of modernism, we thought that we could break away, you know, from the kind of reductionism and essentialism that we were criticizing. And of course, that involved eliminating precisely the artists who were associated with that. I don't have anything against Roberto Mata, Wilfredo Lam, Frida Kahlo, etc., but it would have been strategically shooting ourselves in the foot if we had included those artists in the exhibition. Of course, also working within the constraints that you have when you're doing that kind of project. Hector Olea and I have both been students of many years of this whole phenomenon of the avant-garde. We were both trained in Marxism. Olea is also an experimental writer. He worked with the concrete art poets in Brazil. He's the official translator into Spanish of Mario de Andrade and Oswald de Andrade, and all the Brazilian writings of that period. So we brought that knowledge to what we thought could be a remapping or an initial map of that phenomenon in Latin America. And that involves, instead of showing all these already established artists, showing a number of artists who had not been recognized, you know, for their contributions. Right now, when we look at these slides, you know, so many of these artists, particularly the constructive ones, are already very well known, and people, there's almost like a canon of constructive art. But we have to remember that at that time, and particularly when we were doing heterotopias, this was the beginning of that whole process. And set out to establish that dialogue, and obviously, you know, no exhibition can really encompass, you know, the totality of a certain phenomenon. And of course, as we discover later on, you know, there were people who were left out that we would have liked to include, but their work was not, nobody had researched it at the time, it was not documented. So, you know, that also involved, you know, an exclusion. Now, when the show came to the United States, it took on a different political strategy because it meant opening up a space in an institution that was encyclopedic by nature, but who had, because of the vision of its director, opened up a space for Latin American art. And so the task at hand with Inverted Utopias was then to open up a new field of understanding here in the United States and to shift the conversation, you know, to areas that had not been dealt with, you know, at all, you know, at that time in the United States. Even the concept of the avant-garde as understood in the Marxist tradition or in the left tradition is something that has never really been dealt with here in the United States. I mean, there's always been a rejection of that aspect. Things like abstract expressionism are really based on 19th century paradigms, and that's what this country really bought into during the Cold War and after. So it was, from our point of view, radical strategy to activate, you know, that space. And actually, during the first 5 or 6 years of my work at the Museum of Fine Arts Houston, we did not show Mexican art as a deliberate strategy. We resisted all the efforts to show Frida Kahlo, Diego Rivera, all these people. We only showed them after we had had a number of exhibitions of Gego, Tisica, and others, where people, our audience, was already sensitized to a different kind of canon. So that's my response.
Gerardo? I mean, it seems that one of the things is that you, Anti-America was really a watershed exhibition, and it's put on the map many artists, but also the voices of many curators. You know, Rachel Weiss was, you know, she's a North American, but also Carolina Ponce León, and you soon after were invited to work in major institutions in New York, the New Museum, in your case, and Carolina Ponce León, El Museo del Barrio. Meaning the exhibition was not only well received, but curatorially your vision was, so that you could come with these fresh perspectives that were not North American, and to come to this country to be able to think about it. In the case of, so I would like to talk about, I mean, I would like for you to talk a little bit about the repercussions also on the professional level, not in an individual, but how they're symptomatic of a changing field of Latin American art within institutions, which did not exactly happen within Latin America. Meaning that type of professional impact did not really influence. So maybe you could talk a little bit about, you know, the relationship of exclusion in terms of specific content in your exhibitions, but also in terms of specific voices within institutions here, and that in relationship to Latin America.
Anti-America was a reaction to the 100 years of the Columbus arrival in America's celebrations. And in that framework, many Latin American, several Latin American art exhibitions were organized from Europe or the United States. And some of them were serious, and they were like really big encyclopedic exhibitions. And Carolina Ponce and I, we were working at the time on a different show, and we were pissed off of what was going on. So the usual case, you know, in Latin America, we began to complain. We had a culture of complaint. So, and at a certain moment, we said, well, okay, we have to do something. Let's try to do, to fight back. And so that was the reason why Anti-America was created. So it was an exhibition, but it was more of a cultural action. And it was also try to create the exhibition as a meaningful entity, an entity signifying on itself, so conveying discourse. And thanks to Carolina Ponce, we had the Banco de la República, which is the bank of the state in Colombia, that backed the exhibition. And so we produced this rarity of a show that was funded in Latin America, conceived, curated, organized, and exported to the North. So reversing the usual way. And so we, also the exhibition was full of exclusions, but also full of inclusions. Some exclusions were made on purpose, like no Argentinian artist, one single Brazilian artist, even though we invited Sildo Meireles, but he couldn't participate because he was very busy at the time. And at the same time, we wanted to give like a different view of Latin America, including African Americans, indigenous North American artists, Chicano, Chicana, Latino, Latinas. So, I mean, it was more about like building discourse and criticizing prevailing notions about Latin America. So it was a heavily curated exhibition in the sense that it was about presenting good art. It was about presenting artists who were unknown in Latin America and even more in the States. But it was also about using the exhibition as a place for criticizing prevailing notions and to use it as a weapon, in a cultural weapon. So I think, as you know, every curation is about choosing, but it's also about excluding, and it's also about frustration. It's an exercise of frustration, as you describe. I mean, the ideal scenario you have in your mind, and then you have to deal with the church, and deal with the government and the institutions. So, you know, you have to manage to readapt the whole project. So, but at the end, anti-America didn't have like a very strong impact in the sense that something that it was like clear at the time. But I think that it established like an example and opened a new avenue. I think that culture, art and culture, they cannot change the world, changer la vie. But they work like, you know, little by little, slowly creating like layers of consciousness that built to try to make things better.
Mm-hmm. We're at the end of our time. So I will probably just moderate the second panel.
I actually, before we wrap up and leave, I actually wanted to ask you, what is the place of Latino art really within your practices? Because your institute has Latin American Latino. You talked about how these exhibitions were Afro, including Afro-American artists and so on. And you talk about global capitalism, which obviously involves the figure of the immigrant. So I really want to hear you speak about, you know, what is the place of Latino art within your practice? And particularly because, you know, we're in an exhibition that relates to collection building. And, you know, it is a museum collection that's being formed. There's a blueprint here for a collection that's being formed in America. Temporary exhibitions form other levels of consciousness, true, but most of them tend to be ephemeral if they're not marked in some form of narrative or discourse or history, say, like a collection. So I wanna get a sense of the place of the Latino, because it seems to me that it's actually rather absent from the discussions around Latin American art.
Well, I think that the Latino and Latinas are excluded in a double way, here and in Latin America.
Yeah.
So that was one of the points we have with Anti-America. For the first time, we show Latino-Latina art in a Latin American country. For the very first time. This is unbelievable.
But doesn't it seem that it happened in the 1990s, and in the last decade or 15 years, the figure of the Latino just does not appear?
The situation improved, but still there's resistance.
Still very resistant. Yeah.
In crisis, we show the ASCO for the first time in Mexico. This is unbelievable. Mm-hmm. I mean, and so on, so on.
I think there's no way, particularly in 2014, to turn back from including Latinos within the whole construct of Latin America. I've been having that discussion for many years. I've been attacked as being, you know, stuck in the 80s. But I do think that it is the new horizon for the Latin American and Latino and Latin American field because we are no longer, when you talk about Latinos, you're no longer talking about the traditional groups of the 1960s of the civil rights movement. You're not talking about Chicanos, Puerto Ricans, and Cuban Americans. The influx of artists into the United States as a result of, you know, all the migration of the last few years is unbelievable. What is happening in New York and all throughout the United States? I have given talks in Washington, D.C., for instance, and the whole room is full with artists from different parts of Latin America. And that same year, I went to Portland, Oregon, which is like the end of the world, according to this country. And you find artists from El Salvador, Honduras, Central America, Chile, all over there. I mean, what is happening? Something is bound to happen out of that, mixture and out of that, those dialogues that are taking place. So I think that we cannot continue to ignore the Latino factor. It is not an easy one, and I say it for experience because when we started the ICAA and the project of the documents, we set out to include Latino art, and it was extremely difficult at the beginning to get the Latin Americans and the Latinos to speak to each other. We almost had to force them, you know, to speak and to start looking for the relationships. And it wasn't until, you know, the Chileans discovered that many Chilean artists who immigrated, for instance, in the 1970s ended up in LA and were working alongside Chicano or Puerto Rican artists that they began to be interested, you know, in what was going on. I mean, the patterns of migration, of travel, of interaction, the artists themselves have established it. And we are being irresponsible and biased, you know, if we turn away from that. Because the alliances are there, and the complexities and the notion of an identity as being completely in flux, not being anything fixed by national borders. I mean, we are at that stage, and we say it in terms of discourse, but we don't want to accept it at the level of practice. And I think, you know, that's a big mistake.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.